They feel that they are true patriots, soldiers who have fought and will again fight for Germany, Teutomaniacs as fiercely hostile to the French as any other German. They sing they will never navigate the free German Rhine as fervently as other Germans. Yet when Becker, who wrote the song, insulted me, Moses Hess, he says, who tried to set it to music, it was in a sense a perfectly natural, though no doubt vicious, act. Chauvinism is a vice, but a racial vice, for races exist, and the Jews belong to a race other than that of the Germans. To deny this is to falsify the facts. To be a race or a nation is not to desire racial or national mastery. It is a disease of nationalism to seek to dominate others. But Jews, like other people, need a normal national life. Semites and Teutons are not mere linguistic categories, he says, but the titles carry no claim to superiority in themselves. Each race has different gifts, and they all contribute to the enrichment of mankind. The Aryan race, according to Hess, have the gift of explanation, that of science, of creating beauty, of creating art. The Semites' genius lies in their ethical insight and their sense of holiness, in the sanctifying of the world by religion. There are no superior and no inferior races. All races are equal, and all races must be made free, and they will cooperate as equals. Like many Christian and Muslim peoples, the Jews have slept a deep sleep under gravestones upon which various preachers have inscribed their sleep-inducing formulae. But the crowing of the Gallic cock has awakened the kingdom of the sleepers, and the French soldiers of progress will break the gravestones, and the peoples are beginning to rise from their graves. Just as Rome, which since Innocent III has been the city of eternal sleep, is today gradually being resurrected as the city of eternal life by its doughty patriots who fight for Italian freedom, so Jerusalem too will arise, hence the title of Roman Jerusalem. The waters of the Tiber, the sound of the victories in North Italy, awake the Jews in their slumbers and resound in the hills of Zion. This is very typical rhetoric of the time. He declares that he too was sunk in a deep dream. It was only in 1840, when the charge of ritual murder was hurled against the Jews of Damascus, that he realized where the truth lay. It dawned on me, he says, for the first time in the midst of my socialist activities, that I belonged to my unfortunate, slandered, despised, and dispersed people. And he goes on to say that he stifled his cry of pain because of the greater sufferings of the European workers. But the awakening of Italy has made him realize that the last of all the national questions, the question of Jewish nationality, must obtain its solution. This question has too long been concealed behind the illusions of the rationalists and the philanthropists who deny the national character of the Jewish religion. The religious reform movement among the German Jews has done nothing, he says, but bring emptiness into Jewish life and break off bounds from the ancient Jewish tree. With a shameful lack of pride, the reformers recommend the Jews to conceal themselves among other nations. With what result? They change their names only so that the anti-Semites might dig up their original Jewish names and fling them in their faces. So the poor Meyer Bear, the composer, is now constantly called in all anti-Semitic newspapers as Jakob Meyer Lippmann Bear. And Ludwig Werner, always called Baruch, which is indeed his real name. Even socialists in Germany indulge in this pastime. This situation is surely humiliating. The Jews of the Middle Ages are persecuted and massacred, but by remaining steadfast and faithful to their ancestral values, they avoided degradation. Modern Jews, especially those who have changed their names, deserve the contumely which openly or secretly is constantly being heaped upon them. Hess proceeded to be as good as his word. First he changed his name from Moritz to his Hebrew name Moses. He said he was sorry that he was not called Itzik. Nothing is worse than flying under false colors. In a moving passage, quite early in the book, he says that, rather interestingly, I don't know how much rabbinical authority there really is for this, he says that Moses was not buried in the Holy Land, whereas the bones of Joseph were carried there, because according to the rabbis, when Moses presented himself before his future father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian, to sue for his daughter's hand, he didn't reveal his true origin. That is to say, he allowed himself to be taken for an Egyptian. He didn't say he was Egyptian, but he didn't say he wasn't. Whereas Joseph revealed himself to his brethren and never disavowed anyone or anything. Because of one moment of weakness, Moses was forbidden to be buried in the land of the ancestors whom he had by his silence abjured. What then are the Jews to do if they are not to remain sorry hypocrites among nations? Hess says that the Jews are made Palestinian patriots by their religion. When his grandfather wept, when he read to him Jeremiah's vision of Rachel in her tomb in Ramah, when he showed him olives and dates, saying with shining eyes, "These come from the land of Israel," he was many miles from his native Rhineland. Jews buy Palestine earth on which to rest their head when they are buried. They carry sprigs of palm bound in myrtle during the Feast of the Tabernacles. And, he might have added, they pray for rain or dew at the seasons at which they were useful in the Holy Land. This is more than a superstition or a dogma. Everything which comes from Palestine, everything that reminds them of it, moves them and is dear to them, in a way that nothing else can. If the Germans are only prepared to accept them at the price of denying their race, their religion, their temperament, their historical memories, their character, the price is not only morally too high, but not capable of being paid at all. The proposal is not only detestable, but quite impracticable. Nor is the solution to be found among those fierce, fundamentalist religious fanatics who, with their heads buried in the sand, denounce all science, all aspects of modern secular life. How, he asks, are the Jews to build a bridge between what he calls the nihilism of the Reform rabbis who have learned nothing and the conservatism of the Orthodox who have forgotten nothing? There is only one solution, and it awaits the Jews upon the banks of the Jordan. The French nation will aid them. France, the great liberator, the first to break the ancient shackles and herald the civil liberties of the Jews as those of other peoples, France must, once it's built the Suez Canal, make it possible for the Jews to establish colonies on its shores. For without soil, he says over and over again, without soil there is no national life. But who will go to this barren eastern country? Not, he says, the Jews of the West. They will stay in various European lands in which they have gained education, culture, honorable positions in society. They are too deeply bound up with Western civilization. They have lost their vitality as Jews. They will not wish to immigrate to a remote and barbarous land. They may place their knowledge, their wealth, their influence at the disposal of the immigrants, but they won't go themselves. For them, Palestine will be at best what Hess calls a spiritual nerve center. Universities will arise there in a common language which all Jews will speak. Who then will go? There is no doubt of that. The Jews of Eastern Europe and of other lands where the ancient faith has kept them solid and insulated from their environment. It is they who will move. Their vitality is like that of corn seeds sometimes found in the graves of Egyptian mummies. Given soil, light, air, they grow and become fertile. The Jewish assimilationists who detest what they call religious obscurantism desire to root out these superstitions. But to crush the rabbinical shell in which Judaism is contained is to crush the seed within. It needs not destruction, but earth to grow in. Then there is an extraordinary excursus, very odd, on the Hasidic movement. Whenever the Reform movement inspired by Moses Mendelssohn is an attempt to dilute Judaism and free the Jewish people on foreign soil, which Hess thinks is impossible, the great revivalist sect of the Hasidim is a genuine development of the Jewish religion, he says, a response to the authentic need for life. Unlike the Reformers, who are using the timber of Judaism for non-Jewish ends, and secretly share Heine's view that the Jewish religion is a misfortune rather than a religion, forgetting that even converted Jews, whether they like it or not, are painfully affected by the condition of the Jewish masses, the Hasidim are a living force among the Jews. It is true that Hess confuses the name of the founder of the Chabad sect of Hasidim, and he speaks of an apocryphal character called Samuel of Vilna instead of Schneur Zalman. But what is remarkable is that any great communist agitator in Paris, or in Cologne for that matter, should have heard of this movement at all, and should have realized at a very earlier date, at 1861, that the founder of this movement, the Baal Shem, was destined in the end to be more effective than Moses Mendelssohn. For Hasidism and Zionism were and are living forces in the sense in which the Reform movement, with all its humanity, all its civilization, all its learning, is not. It is the benighted beings, it is these benighted beings, of whom there are millions, says Hess, in the dominions of Russian, Prussian, Austrian, and Turkish empires, the Jews of these backward provinces who will go to Palestine and create a new state. There the existence of Jewish self-identity will not need to be, as he puts it, either demonstrated or demonstrated away. As for the other Jews, they will, if they want to, assimilate to the countries of their birth.